If film history has proved anything, it's that work that it was deemed very important fades into obscurity. Work that was totally ignored becomes very important.
These are ideas that are completely unrestrained, not just by the studio system, but even like the normal concept of how a movie would work.
I made a documentary about driver's education films made in Ohio back in the 60s.
Did you direct Hell's Highway?
I did.
I like that movie.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Preservation, restoration, and saving work has value, but what is it ultimately towards? And my personal feeling is that it's towards being shown forever. You know, so as long as this work is out there, shouldn't be locked away. And what everyone who's working on projects here has in common is the desire to preserve and restore these works, go towards the end of them, not going in the vault, but actually going out in some way into the world. And this type of work, philosophically, I see as twofold. One, it's a reclamation of the artist's work. It's reclamation of artist's legacies. It's also sort of a reclamation of a shared cultural history that we have. And if film history has proved anything, it's that work that it was deemed very important fades into obscurity. Work that was totally ignored becomes very important. It's constantly being rewritten. And the history of cinema has just been so short compared to other major art forms that we're only beginning to sort of experience the upheaval and the changes of how work will be considered. So it's a chance to celebrate the work. It's a chance to show the incredible work that people are doing in certain fields. And it's also a chance to sort of potentially change sort of the accepted canon of what work is important. So that leads me into specifically what Artists Public Domain and Cinema Conservancy does. And what we started doing a couple of years ago is looking at films that have always meant something to us, specifically American independent films, but that were maybe available on DVD, but not theatrically, or vice versa. Prints existed, but there was no way for it to be seen on other platforms. The goal is twofold. One, to get the work back to a form that is as close to the way it looked when it was created and as close as the artist's vision. And in a lot of cases, they're filmmakers who have made work 50 years ago who are still around and waiting to be engaged to relook at their work. Then there's also over to preservation, work that exists but cannot be shown because of deterioration or other things that have happened to it. And the act of preservation is creating new materials which will serve as new masters for which then copies can be made on different platforms, digital or on film. And what Cinema Conservancy is trying to do is conceive from the beginning of projects that will be either restored or preserved, but part of that entire project to have the end goal being that they're able to be seen. And for us, we specialize in doing that theatrically. We have a lot of partners that we work with who specialize in other platforms, digital platforms, and home viewing. But for us, we want to be able to return the films, say, as much as possible to the form that they were created on, which generally is 16 or 35 millimeter, and then find a way to exhibit them in theaters to audiences that might not be aware of them, or to reintroduce them. And to that end, particularly proud of the work we've done with a film called Nothing But a Man, a film called Northern Lights, which there were no screenable prints of since it had won an award in 1975 when it won the Camera d'Or. And one of the first examples of regional filmmaking was shot in North Dakota in 1978. And most recently, our project with Manny Kirschheimer, which is an ongoing project beginning with his film Stations of the Elevated, which was shot on 16 millimeter and needed restoration. It also needed help in terms of legal issues, and that's also part of this as well, where films may have never had their music cleared or other things that need to be worked out that have prevented the films from being seen. So that was our most recent project. The project that I'm going to highlight today is one that came very unexpectedly. It was a 1 minute film that was discovered in the storage space of Mary Engel. Mary is the daughter of Morris Engel and Ruth Orkin, the directors of Little Fugitive and Weddings and Babies, and also very important photographers. And we found a little reel in Mary's storage that smelled terribly from deterioration and just said Oreo. So already, like, potentially very exciting. And what we discovered was that Morris had photographed and directed a 1 minute commercial for Oreo, which had some value as a work of art, but also was an award winner. But an award that is not generally associated with major works of art. The award is the best baked goods and confectionery commercial of the year 1956. I should just also add that it didn't just win one. This is a combined award that brought in all aspects of baked goods. But this is a film that we did not know where a negative was. We did not know if any other copies existed. And being that it was short, it was a good way for us to put our toe into doing a full 35 millimeter restoration and preservation. So from this one positive print we had, we were able to create a new negative. We were able to print copies of it that are now in the permanent collection at the Museum of Modern Art and Harvard. We have a copy as well. There's no way to sort of capitalize on it monetarily in any way, but is, I think, a really important work by a really important filmmaker that helps tell his story of his art a bit more. So that is where I'll leave you. So this is Little Girls Have Pretty Curls by Morris Engel.
Little girls have pretty curls, but I like Oreo. Oreo's my choice because it's the very best cookie ever was. Girls are nice, but boy, what icing comes with Oreo. They say on television it's America's favorite cookie. Grown-up people don't know what they're missing. Oreo, Oreo, Oreo. Well, all gone. Do, 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 but I like Oreo.
I'd like now to introduce our first speaker who has a project that will be launched soon from Union Docs discussing his film, or the film Los Sures. Join me in welcoming Christopher Allen.
So maybe I'm going to sing this introduction, so inspired by that video. My name is Christopher Allen, and I'm the Executive Artistic Director of Union Docs, and we're a center for documentary art located about 10, 15 minutes walk from here in the south side of Williamsburg. Thank you so much to the Kickstarter team for inviting us to be here. The film that we're going to show you some clips of tonight was given to us in 2007 on VHS. We were showing the work of Pamela Yates and Paco Dionis, two filmmakers who actually live quite close to Union Docks. And they said, have you ever seen this documentary that's out there about the neighborhood that you're a part of here with your organization? And we hadn't. And when we watched the film, it really opened up a door to a history that was completely inaccessible to us. It allowed us to create a whole set of relationships in the neighborhood and understand really what this place was. So it was thrilling, but we only had this VHS copy. And so for the last actually 5 years, we've been working on a project called Living Los Ures, which is sort of takes that film. And at the center of that project is a restoration. We were able to find a version of it with the New York Public Library. They had the only existing print of this film. We had thought that it was much better protected than that, but it actually was quite at risk of being lost. We were able to make a restoration from that. But also beyond, and the film was made by Diego Echeverria in 1984 at a time when this neighborhood was at the poorest point that it had ever been. It was a place of a lot of violence and drugs. And we were really interested in what was possible to work with the neighborhood today as a center of documentary art located in the place. So we expanded beyond that project by producing 30 short documentaries about Los Ures today. And so you'll see some clips from that. Those are made with fellows at Union Docs. We also made a community platform that cut the film up into 326 shots that it's composed of, and used those shots as a way to splice in the stories, videos, and pictures of many community members from around Los Ures. And finally, we located one of the characters from the film, Marta Avias. And actually, in fact, we located many of the characters in the film, but we made a web documentary sort of updating her story. So tried to show you a little piece of all that work, because that makes up, we're kind of looking at this as a creative restoration, as you know, this restoration as a moment to do a whole set of other work around it. And first, what you'll see is a clip from Los Ures. And then you'll see a few, a little trailer for the shorts and two excerpts from two of the shorts. One, which of Memory in Los Ures, which premiered at BAMF's Cinema Fest, and the other, Tonitas, which premiered at MoMA's Doc Fortnite. And then after that, you'll see the little clip from Shot by Shot, and then the web documentary. So just to preface that, and I might just give us a little introduction before each of those. And so, yeah, leave it with that.
Oh, actually, I will say briefly, there's one more thing. The first clip you'll see is actually very low resolution from our earliest sort of trailer for the project. And so you'll be able to see that's from the VHS that we worked with for like 5 years before finally getting the scanned film. And then the later clips you'll see are from the scanned film in an intermediate stage prior to color correction and sort of sound work that is just about complete now. So so you have an idea of what you're looking at, you actually see the restoration in this clip. So.
Across the East River from Manhattan lies a small community of some 20,000 Hispanic people, most of them Puerto Rican. It is the poorest section of New York City. This is a portrait of that neighborhood.
They call this the South Side, you know, because mostly everybody is Spanish, so they call it in Spanish, Los Sures.
Los Sures are tough. If you can survive Los Sures, you can survive anything.
I heard two shots. Boom, boom, you know. I seen my friend holding my little brother, you know, by his arm. He was like with a hole in his back, a little hole in the front, a big blasted hole in his back, you know. All that went into my mind was to pick him up and grab him and hug him, you know, and start kissing him and tell him, why? And I left real crazy saying, how I'm gonna tell my mother? How I'm gonna tell my mother? Who's gonna tell her? I ain't gonna tell my mother, you know?
I wish that I was a working person and that I could be, you know, the person providing for my kids and for myself. But that has not been the case. I have not been able to work. I have not been able to be properly educated to hold a job that will pay enough for me to support myself and my kids.
As you know, this is a neighborhood of struggle. Now, we've been struggling since we were kids. You know, if it ain't one struggle, it's another struggle. But you're always fighting. You gotta fight. Here's this neighborhood. All of a sudden, man, funds come in to fix it up, you know, renovate it, to create jobs for the neighborhood. All of a sudden, everybody comes from Queens, Long Island, Staten Island, from Jersey, to work here. And the people from here, they ain't got a decent job.
The talking about Osuna is about a documentary that was done in 1984.
When did evolution come to a full stop?
Osuna.
This is a clip from one of the shorts.
I was born in Williamsburg section of Brooklyn, New York.
You know, South Second, South Third.
South First, South Second, South Third.
South Fourth.
South First, South Second, South Third.
South First, South Second, South Third, like that. You know, the names on the street.
That's why they call it Los Sures.
If you're in Brooklyn and people ask you where you're from and you're Latino, you would say Los Sures and they would know exactly where you're from. Soy de Los Sures.
Los Sures. Los Sures. Los Sures. Los Sures.
Maria, 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 Maria. She's like this really special character. She's really quiet. She will see you in a corner and she would just only smile, but she wouldn't interact with anybody unless you actually approach her and talk to her. It just kind of like, it makes you really wonder about her life.
80 mulos.
Se lo preparo ahorita, sí, doña.
Okay.
So Maria runs the last remaining social club in Williamsburg, Caribbean social club in Williamsburg, and she also on the weekends feeds people there because most of the food pantries are closed, so that's actually why she's buying the beans, which is such a great shot. The next clip that you're going to see is of the project Shot by Shot, which chops up the film from 1984 into each of its 326 shots, and I'll speak a little bit over that.
We started showing the film around the neighborhood. Seeing the film brought out so many insights and memories.
That's my building. My mother still lives in that building.
Details from the background, captured by chance in the film, opened the door for amazing stories to be told.
It's documented that you guys were breakdancers over there.
We met so many awesome people.
We cut up the original into individual shots.
The Shot by Shot website was born to gather these connected experiences while we can.
To use each shot in the film as the beginning of a conversation.
To make this important and rich history accessible.
To share the personality, humor, and wisdom of Los Sures.
Park Slope, beautiful neighborhood. Who do I know about there? Nobody. I used to go there just to sleep.
So this is the website, and you can navigate to any of the shots one at a time. And it pulls it up, and you can play the shot itself, or as you scroll, text, images, not seeing the caption there, but and highlights are brought up. These have all been gathered through this sort of oral history project. We've interviewed 40 long-term residents of the neighborhood, people who are connected to the film in different ways. And are hoping to eventually get 100 people participating. And we currently have about 450 sort of stories. We've actually mapped all the shots that are exterior. And we have 450 stories and are looking eventually to have 1,500. Last piece that I want to show you. So for the whole time watching this film, we were really curious about how we could meet the some of the original people. And Marta, whose voice you heard in an earlier clip, was a particularly fascinating person that we wanted to connect with. And so we've been looking and trying to find a way to do that. And one day we actually just went to the local bodega and we're like, do you know Marta? Like, this is what she looks like. And so they're like, oh yeah, 330 South Third. And that's like how tight-knit the community is. And she was literally maybe 4 minutes walk away from Union Docks. So we worked with her for about 2 years and made a web documentary that is part of POV Suite. So we'll play a little clip of that.
I don't find the need to leave Williamsburg to move to another area.
I'm gonna deal my problems here.
We tracked down the original subjects of the film, such as Marta Viles.
In life, you choose. You make choices, and you have to live with them.
We produce 89 Steps, an interactive documentary about Marta's life today.
That's me and my dog.
Stay. I'm used to climbing these stairs. It's 89 steps, by the way. I want you to know, from the first floor all the way up to my apartment.
Let me know if you get tired. I'll stop and wait for you.
Mumu climbs them stairs like a champ. The only bad thing about this place is that I'm 65 years old now. Imagine when I'm older, climbing up 89 steps. That's gonna be like really hard to do, you know?
So that thing is a lot more fun to play with online than watch on the screen. So you can go to 89.losures.com check it out. And we finished the first four chapters of that web doc and are hoping to finish now the last four chapters. So thanks for your time. I'll talk to you after.
Okay. Hey, my name is Paul Miller, aka DJ Spooky, and it's a real pleasure to be here. I'm a writer, artist, and DJ music producer. So I'm going to be here kind of talking about a project we're doing with Kino Lorber. And one of the things that from Jake and from some of the other people I've seen tonight that seems to be a common thread is that it's not really about restoration per se, it's about activation. So the films that you're going to be seeing, I'm going to play a clip in a moment. I'm a big fan of the idea that the archive is not dead. And in fact, one could say in DJ culture, you're only as good as your archive. So I collect old records, and I've made a career out of that as someone who's involved heavily in sampling. And what you're going to see is a very rare collection of African-American cinema from the beginning of the kind of the end of the 19th and early 20th century. Now, this is a hidden dimension of American culture precisely because of the height of segregation that happened with the Hollywood system. So what you're going to be seeing is the kind of a hidden spectrum of what ended up happening, which African Americans made their own movie theaters, and much like what's going on with Kickstarter, some of the people that you're going to see, like Oscar Michaud, he would actually encourage people to do subscriptions to his films to pay for them in advance. So a lot of people would actually donate money to help the films be made. And again, this is in the turn of the last century. He's very far ahead of his time. And I kind of came to film archival restoration from a paradoxical place. We ended up getting the rights from an open source point of view to D.W. Griffith's film, Birth of a Nation. And I can assure you I'm not a Klan member, in just a little. But the whole idea was that a lot of early DJs would call themselves, you know, Grandmaster Flash, Grand Wizard Theodore, and they didn't know that those are also Klan titles. You know, It's one thing to be a Grand Wizard, you know, in Kentucky, and another to be a Grand Wizard in the South Bronx, you know. So I'm a big fan of this idea of the mashup and the idea that the remix makes our archival material more vivid, more robust, and it creates a much more resonant relationship between contemporary culture and history. So with that being said and done, I think the entire theme that you're going to be seeing is these are rare gems from the beginning of not only American cinema overall, but from a very distinct point of view of African-American cinema that's quite powerful. So we're going to be doing this over the period of a year. The idea is that these need to be restored and put in new kinds of prints, and we'll be looking at that from the viewpoint of not only how we did the research and archival restoration, but we're going to commission composers and artists to respond to the history of cinema from a current point of view. So with that said and done, I'm not going to be on the panel, but if you have questions afterwards, I'd be happy to respond. So if we can play the clip, it's 4 minutes.
Hi, this is Paul D. Miller, better known in the pop culture world as DJ Spooky. I'd like to talk to you about early African-American cinema, a fascinating but often neglected chapter in film history. These films provide rare glimpses at the neighborhoods, the churches, the people of black communities in the first half of the 20th century. We see reflected in these films our aspirations, our hopes, our fears. In a way, they represent a version of America that has rarely been seen. There was no place in the Hollywood studio system for African-American filmmakers, and only a very narrow place for performers. So against almost impossible odds, African-American film directors like Oscar Michaud and Spencer Williams, and white filmmakers such as Richard Norman, crafted their own film companies in whatever cities they were in. Detroit, Omaha, Philadelphia, Jacksonville. For years, this was considered their greatest achievement, having carved out their own film production, distribution, and exhibition network outside of the Hollywood studio system.
You skunk, and I'm gonna kill you if it's the last thing I do on this earth.
But give these films another look, and you'll see something more. These filmmakers weren't just imitating or competing with Hollywood studio films. They were cultivating their own unique styles of storytelling, and they were not afraid to confront controversial topics in both the African-American and wider American culture. Pioneers of African-American Cinema is a treasure trove of important films, a deluxe four-disc collection newly mastered from archival film elements, digitally restored in high definition. Many of these films have never been available on video. Some have been available in the past, but never in special high-definition editions like these. We'll not only present the landmarks of this remarkable film movement, such as Oscar Michaud's Within Our Gates, we'll also show you the lively entertainments, like The Flying Ace. You'll see motion picture sermons that were meant to be screened not in theaters, but in churches and revival meetings. You'll see films made by women, such as this rare documentary footage shot by novelist Zora Neale Hurston among the Gullah people of South Carolina. You'll see lost films of the beginnings of the 20th century that exist only in fragments. They show a dimension of African-American culture that has rarely been seen.
And I hope you'll come back to church next Sunday.
I'm Mabel, and of course you can expect me back.
The work has yet to be done, so what you're seeing here are clips taken from existing masters. And as you can see, new high-definition masters are long overdue. The silent films will be accompanied by new musical scores. Some of them will replicate the 1920s movie-going experience, while others will have a more contemporary flavor, from various artists involved with contemporary classical music, to jazz, to hip-hop, to techno, and so on, challenging our perception of these films as simply historical artifacts. For more than 25 years, Kino Lorber has specialized in releasing silent and classic films on video. And the films featured in Pioneers of African American Cinema will undergo the same careful treatment. Film historians Charles Musser and Jacqueline Stewart are curating the collection and are writing program notes for each of the films. They, executive producer Paul D. Miller, aka DJ Spooky, myself, along with other writers, performing artists, and filmmakers, will appear in a series of on-camera interviews discussing the enduring value of these rare films. So with your support and encouragement, we will help to preserve and restore a vitally important chapter of film history, of American history, and bring it before the eyes and ears of a new generation of viewers. Thanks in advance for your support.
Hi, my name is Zach. I've come from Austin, Texas, where we have a video label called Bleeding School Video, but that really started 10 years ago when a guy named Joseph Ziemba started reviewing what he called trash horror films on a website called bleedingskull.com. And since then, that has just grown only in the number of reviews. It has no financial ambitions or anything, but it is a website that people go to learn about movies that have never been given any sort of critical assessment of any kind and probably would never deserve to in a lot of people's, outlook. But really, Joseph started the site to defend movies that were unloved and most people would consider unwatchable. Annie Choi is here. She's another writer for the website. and I write one review a year, but I really put all my work into doing Bleeding Skull Video, which kind of furthers the same affection for these movies in actually releasing them. This is something we started in 2014. There'd been a review on the website called Cards of Death, a movie that was shot in Los Angeles in 1986, but only ever released in Tokyo on VHS for 2 weeks before the company went out of business. We reviewed the movie, I loved the movie so much, and the director contacted us and said, his exact words, how the hell did you get my movie? Send me my movie. So he didn't have a copy of it, and that kind of inspired this idea of, like, it's one thing to just tell everybody how great something is, but it's another thing to actually make it available where people can enjoy it. And I guess, obviously, that falls into what this entire night is about. So the project that we are now most excited to tackle, and it's the biggest thing we've ever done, is going to be, I believe, our seventh release. And that is a movie by a director named James Bryan, who's an exploitation superhuman that kind of started doing adult films, like so many of these guys did, in the mid-70s, and worked his way into doing action movies, and then kind of made his first dollar profit in the 80s with a horror film called Don't Go in the Woods. And he was one of these people that, I mean, a lot of us probably appreciate if we're the type of people who are here. Somebody who didn't have any financial backing whatsoever, didn't have any formal training, and just went into the movie business out of sheer just, you know, obsession and interest and devotion to their own ideas. And that's the reason that we like these movies. It's not just that it's cute that you have some low budget movie, there's no irony in watching it, but it's like these are ideas that are completely unrestrained, not just by the studio system, but even like the normal concept of how a movie would work. So that's why, you know, the term trash horror is actually very affectionate. It's like this is what most people would say is trash, but it really does show a unique vision that is not available in any other way, in any other genre. And James Bryan exemplifies that to us, and he made movies that you might have seen before. Lady Street Fighter, Don't Go in the Woods is kind of his biggest hit. But he kept working after the 70s, and after he kind of did, you know, had a little bit of success in the 80s, he was still making movies. And eventually that was straight to home video, and when the straight to VHS market dried up, he was left with one project that he had completely finished called Run Coyote Run. And he had made this movie, and he made 10 copies of it, so everybody in the crew got a copy of the film. Nobody would distribute it at all. And a friend of mine bought a used car in San Francisco in 2013, and in the trunk was a bunch of McDonald's bags and Run Coyote Run on VHS. This is true. And he said, I think you like this bullshit. I'm going to mail you this tape, is what he said in his email. He sent it. And it was a lost James Bryan movie. He's this filmmaker that everybody involved in the site really loves. And he lives in Texas, as we do. So we drove 4 hours to his barn, where he has stored his entire history of exploitation triumphs. You know, I mean, everything he's ever touched is all out in this huge place. And he said, yeah, you can release Run Coyote Run. Here are the masters. Too bad no one's going to ever release my other movie that was lost and nobody's ever heard of, which we didn't even know existed. And that was the movie you guys are going to see. Well, you're going to see kind of an entire scope of James Bryan's work. But what we're here to talk about really is Jungle Trap. And this was his last movie. He shot it on camcorder because he had, you know, lost all of his opportunity to use film at this point. And he made it with his longtime collaborator, Renee Harmon, who is his star. Like, she was, you know, the De Niro to his Scorsese, if you will. They'd worked together since the mid-70s, and she was an acting teacher that would have her students pay to have parts in the movies that she made with James Bryan. And their big last project was this film Jungle Trap, which was really ambitious because it all takes place in the jungles of South America, but it's all shot in the valley in LA. And they put everything they had into it. They used all of their best stock players from her acting classes, and he shot everything, but when he started talking to distributors, they just blacklisted him. They said, you know, you're ludicrous, you're shooting on a camcorder, nobody wants this type of work anymore, the market's changed. And he was so heartbroken and so shattered that he never edited the film, he never did a sound mix, and he never did a soundtrack. So 25 years later, we were in his barn, and he said, yeah, here's the unfinished masters. And he said, do you want us to finish your movie? Do you want us to hire somebody that can do this? They can help us do this. And so now it looks like with the help of Kickstarter and whoever wants to contribute to this, there's going to be people involved, including people who worked professionally who've asked to be part of this project, including somebody who worked on The Wire. Am I allowed to say this? Somebody who worked on the show The Wire wants to finish this shot on video horror film from 1990. So we really have an opportunity to kind of erase some of this guy's heartbreak and share his work with the world. And he really is one of the most unique, bizarre, fearless, and just completely non-human filmmakers that have ever existed. So rather than just show you some of the usable clips from the very raw version of Jungle Trap, we instead have a 5-minute overview of what James Bryan and Renee Harmon have done together. So we're gonna watch that, and then if it comes up on the panel, we'll tell you more. But thank you guys so much. Thank you, Kickstarter. Thank you, Jake. And enjoy 5 minutes of the insanity of James Bryan.
Smokers and suck them over on our side.
Love it to the grave. Never miss a chance to keep us free.
You.
Lizard Womb had just discovered the plot to take over the universe with bionic robots.
Forget all the hoopla surrounding the fact that she eats pets for breakfast, and just throw out everything you knew about her radical feminoid conspiracy theory.
Out of calls, 2:30. What next?
That guy Peter flew the coop. We got to look out for him, too.
We got a mental case, too?
Yeah, and that's not all. Just got a call from the National Guard. No copter. They say it's county business. Got to take care of it ourselves.
We don't have a copter.
Yeah, I know.
Honey, can you give me a light bulb?
I'll never know why they saddled me with a psychic female cop.
Get you there, you know. They tore the tracks down years ago.
Oh, there you are. I've been looking all over for you. Rita! Rita, don't hide on me! You're pissing me off!
And I'm here from Oscilloscope Laboratories. We're a New York-based independent film distribution company. We release narrative features and documentaries in theaters, on digital platforms, on DVD, and on Blu-ray. My role there is mostly doing content sort of production, doing the DVDs and Blu-ray releases, doing all the creative direction, producing all the extra features, and doing online digital content now too. So I'm here to talk about Kelly Reichardt's River of Grass. And I tell people that we're going to restore Kelly's first debut feature, or first film. And everyone says, oh, you're going to do Old Joy. And no, we're not doing Old Joy. And people don't know about River of Grass. So that's why this project for us is really exciting. Oscilloscope released Wendy and Lucy and Meek's Cut Off. So we're long-term partners with Kelly Reichardt. She's part of our family. Love her work and are really excited to be involved in River of Grass. River of Grass came to us before I actually worked at Oscilloscope, so I don't know the full story, so I can't give you the full history of it. But the rights became available and we scooped it up. It exists in a 16 millimeter print. That isn't particularly great. There's no high definition master of it at all. So Oscilloscope plans on doing a restoration of it and doing a 2K digital scan that we can make available to the wider community. Representing it to people who saw it at Sundance in 1994, where it originally debuted, and then showing it to everyone who thinks that there is no film before Old Joy. So the clip I'm gonna show, it's about a 5 or 6 minute clip. And it's the film is about these two characters, Cozy and Lee. Cozy is sort of this unhappy, bored, disaffected housewife. Lee is sort of a layabout around town. They meet each other one night in a bar when Cozy is out trying to have some excitement one night. And they decide to go pool hopping afterwards after a night of drinking and flirting at this bar. Things go terribly awry. Nothing goes as expected in their life and in the story of the film. Kelly has called this a road movie without the road, a crime story without the crime, and a love story without the love. So I think I'll leave you with that, and you can watch the clip, and then we can talk about it more in the panel.
Did you ever wonder what it would be like to be held up in some motel somewhere, seeing your life played out on TV, knowing that the whole world was looking for you? You know, this place is pretty creepy looking in the daylight.
You don't by chance carry around a toothbrush with you, do you? Oh, shit! There's a palmetto bug in there! Don't let him come out!
Well, give me something to smash it with.
Well, hold on! Shut up! We don't even have our shoes!
Bible.
Here.
shit out of the tiles, though.
Thing is, 16 good?
No, 20 is good.
Lee and I had crossed that straight line that Dad called the law, and I could feel the butterflies in my stomach as I tumbled deeper into a life of crime.
I do a lot of predominantly film-related documentaries and DVD, Blu-ray supplemental bonus features. One of the films that Subculture is interested in preserving is a German crime film called Bloody Friday. It is based on a true story about a the dog day afternoon of Munich, which is how I describe it to people. Equal parts Herschel Gordon Lewis and Sam Peckinpah when you see the actual film. It's the film, I think, will speak for itself. We've got about 5 minutes of clips. The film actually, why we want to restore this movie is the negative is completely lost and damaged. Can't do anything with it. Their film prints are all faded and completely unusable, but there is a very good interpositive that we'll be using if we're successful with this Kickstarter presentation that we're going to be doing. It's a pretty wild film. It's never actually been released theatrically in the United States. There is an English cut version that's on YouTube, but who wants to watch a movie on YouTube? So what we're going to do is just restore this film and do a proper 2K restoration and create a brand new subtitled track to go along with it, because the English dub is not a literal translation of what the German actors are saying. And I think I'll just let the clips speak for themselves. What you'll see is is in German. There are no subtitles, but I think you can follow it. That's the opening credits of the film. A breakout, a getaway, a little bit of a bank storming, and what happens when toddlers play with hand grenades. So here you go. Thank you. Bloody Friday.
Also mach schnell und nicht zuriegeln.
Wir passen schon auf, dass dich keiner stört. Zigarette?
Nein, danke schön, das lohnt sich nicht.
Ein paar Züge sind's doch.
Ja, ja.
Jetzt hat er Manschettenweste.
Ja, ich weiß nicht, ein ausgepuffter Hund. Der hat vielleicht der Grippe schon was aufzulesen gegeben. Und immer gleich mit dem da.
Das soll er mal bei mir versuchen.
Da fahren so. Hallo, Gerichtsdiener!
Was ist denn da drauf für ein Theater?
Warte ich aber noch. Das ist alles verqualmt. Du, Moment mal.
Vorwärts geht, komm uns raus. Da draußen brennt irgendwas. Und da soll ihn vielleicht rausholen.
Ja, ja, ich komm ja schon.
Rupp, komm, wir können gehen. Komm uns raus, geht.
Keinen Mucks. Oder ich knall dich hier im Scheißhaus zusammen, du Drecksack.
Geht, geht. Um Gottes Willen, machen Sie sich nicht unglücklich.
Das Schweinerei verregt dich.
Du Drecksack, keine Bewegung.
Doch, und
halt, 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 hal
Come on, Dee. Presto! Keine Bewegung! Ah! Alles der Perlin!
Das ist ein Überfall! Keine Bewegung! Wenn Sie unseren Anordnungen folgen, passiert niemand was.
Wenn nicht, wird auf Sie geschossen. Ohne Rücksicht!
Niki, ich bring dich zu deiner Mami. Komm, Niki, ich bring dich zu deiner Mutti. Du brauchst keine Angst haben, ist doch alles gut. Wir gehen jetzt zu deiner Mami. Komm, Niki, es ist ja alles gut. Niki!
Schnell! Komm!
Wow. Elijah.
Yes.
You're kind of hiding in plain sight. You didn't see that coming. So we'll start with your film. A film not released in the United States, and a film and a genre, a subgenre, probably not known to a lot of people. And I think we'll begin with that, but I think a lot of the films our work, but what's uniting this work is stuff that might be known to connoisseurs or fans or researchers, but not to a wider public. I would say, with the exception of perhaps Kelly Reichardt's film, because she has attained some more recent success, and then, of course, in the case of Michaud. But even with someone like Michaud, the work seems much more written about than actually scene. But to begin with your project, a film that clearly is going to find an enthusiastic audience once it's presented to them.
Yeah.
So what's the plan in terms of, and maybe you can speak a little bit more about some of the sort of technical details, because I want the discussion of preservation and restoration to be pretty transparent, because a lot of terms get thrown around, and those things sort of prevent people from understanding it. So let's talk maybe a little bit more specifically about the work that's going to be done, and then what the end product is going to be in terms of how it's going to be exhibited and shown and presented.
Okay. Well, I think, like I said earlier, the negative is completely destroyed. This was a German, French, and Italian co-production, and what you'll often find with a lot of those 70s exploitation, crime, horror films is elements are lost, they get shuffled around from laboratories in different countries and yada yada. But this negative has just not been taken care of. They just, once it, it's made for a very specific market next year, and once that market is satisfied, it's forgotten about. But it has a very large audience in Germany, not very large of an audience in the United States. It did have a VHS release in the US. The German edition is actually uncut. The European or the American version is missing a few minutes. So what we'll do is restore the interpositive, which is a direct copy of the negative. So it's the next generation. It's your next best option. I don't know in terms of what true cineasts would say about that, but it's the only option we have. I think the color representation is there in that interpositive. It's that also needs a lot of work, but you can pull the colors out of it. Most importantly, it's uncut, and we'll be piecing together different sources for the soundtracks. We'll be having an English dub as well as the German track. Those will be sourced from probably film prints.
And I might have missed it, but what was the initial year of production and release?
The production release?
The year of production
and
the year
of
release.
It's from 1972.
1972, because that's another thing that I think all of the films, with the exception of the Kino Lorber projects, have in common, is they're fairly recent. And it's there's sort of a notion that the stuff that's missing is quite old. The stuff that's in need of work is quite old. But in fact, four out of the five projects are fairly recent, in one case, not even completed. So it doesn't seem, there's sort of a misconception that the mistakes that people made before we were all here are not being repeated, but in fact they are being repeated, either by the people who control the films, like I guess in your case, an international distributor who's only really concerned about that initial run, or a smaller filmmaker like Diego with his film, where he just doesn't have the capacity or to look after something, or for whatever miscellaneous reasons, flooding or whatever it may be, labs closing, not returning materials, that it's what the work that everyone here is doing is really crucial in terms of sort of picking up and continuing on something that the filmmakers would have liked to have done. It's not out of their own personal neglect, it's just something that happened. So is that the case, some of the case that happened with Diego? How did we get to the point where there was only one film in the New York Public Library?
Yeah, I mean, well, this is a time before there really is much of a home video market, right? For this, especially for documentaries at this time. So there, you know, he was kind of, when the film went through its theatrical distribution, when it went to festivals, when it eventually was broadcast on TV, it was kind of done for him. And he didn't, he sold the outtakes to an archive and assumed that sort of the libraries would take the role for it. But we were very lucky that actually the print that the New York Public Library had in their reserve collection was made from the original, some of the original elements. It was made in a different way than the prints that went to all these other libraries that the Library of Congress had, for instance. And those prints were bright red and had deteriorated. So it was a shock to me to understand that really there wasn't somebody fighting for all this kind of work unless it sort of rose to the top. And it was, you know, due to the library. Basically, because of some the attention that we were bringing to it and the desire that we had and the way that we brought Diego to the table, too, they sort of advanced it on their list, and they have a very long list of things that they'd like to restore as well. So maybe they'll do a Kickstarter.
And part of the thing that each of you will be engaging in is partnerships with either archives or laboratories that are best suited or that you have come to create a relationship with, but there's this other aspect of it that requires someone who's skilled, and also in the cases of yours, so let's say everyone here is playing more of a curatorial role, but there's this whole other area of people who are crucial to this process, and we're in some ways acting as an intermediary between the filmmakers or their estates, and then the people who are gonna be able to do the work. But luckily, in the case of this film, Diego's here and he's able to approve, or Kelly's around and I'm sure she'll be involved herself. I mean, let's talk about your film, because that's totally unique. I mean, there's a version that he intended to make, that there's some documents that'll be adhered to.
Well, he's alive. He's going to do it with us.
Yeah, no, yeah. Exactly. That's what I was right. saying. He's not being turned over. I mean,
yeah,
this is like Touch of Evil.
Well, what he ended up giving us, it's like Touch of Evil, but better.
Yeah.
No, he ended up cobbling together a version that he made a DVD-R of, and it's basically the rough version of the movie, but you know everything is so raw and there's no soundtrack. And there's really points where they'll cut to a scene and an actress is sitting there and you'll just hear him go, cry, and she'll just do this. Yeah. And like that's the version of the movie. And it's tempting to actually release that version as well because it's like so voyeuristic to watch it, because you're just seeing, I mean, there'll be people being like, hey, Mike, you owe me $2. And they'll be like, oh, and then they go into their scene. I mean, that's really in the movie. And so it's like, it's not just like the boom mic sort of thing where you're aware of what's happening, but it's like, it's not like the fourth wall is lost. It's like the people are actually sitting on your couch with you, and it's really bizarre. But it needs to be transformed into the film that he wants. It would be unfair to just release the, you know, the patchwork, messy incarnation of the movie. And so he's really excited, because this is the movie that wrecked his career. He had made, I believe, 12 features and put everything he had into making 12 features, and just like the complete disappointment of how the market distributors reacted to his project without even seeing it is just what took him out of the business. And he wasn't, you know, old. I mean, he was still very active and still had all these ideas, and this is what broke him. And so...
But it's interesting that, but this is gonna, and I specifically in this case, this is gonna open a window onto a type of regional filmmaking and a type of format that he was using to make films that it's unknown to a lot of people.
Yeah, the shot on video thing is weird. Most people assume that really pornography was the only type, you know, the type of films being shot on camcorders in the late 80s, early 90s. There was a New York Times piece 3 years ago about a movie, maybe 2 years ago, about Black Devil Doll from Hell. Yep. And Tales from the Quad Ed Zone, which was a horror film that got a lot of, you know, street credibility that had been shot on video. And it was a really fascinating story, and it kind of raised awareness that this is a medium, and this is something that people enjoy.
But at the time, and I don't know if he said this himself, I mean, inconceivable that someone was going to show up these years later and say, your work is something that is of interest to us and that we want to in some way help finish and get back out there. I mean, I know that's gratifying for anyone in a curatorial position, but it's also something that shows that as I was alluding to before, something that for all intents and purposes has completely disappeared from popular culture is now going to be brought back in, and something that was just completely an unpredictable, one of the many unpredictable things that 50 years from now, there might be a thought that it was unbelievable that there was ever a time that this wasn't part of general discussion, you know, which I guess, I think I'm doing a very good job from segueing from guest to guest, but it wasn't planned this way. But to speak, that leads us to the work of someone like Michaud, where the exhibitions of the films at the time, very regional.
Right.
There was, for reasons of prejudice and segregation, separate theaters. Separate. These are not films that everyone got to see, and were in some cases relegated to one particular audience. So in some ways, this is as much of a historical project as a cinematic project. And someone like Michaud, as I've said before, is someone who's written about and not seen as often. And sometimes I think because of the very poor conditions of Michaud's prints and material specifically, cannot be fully assessed. Right. Is that sort of one of the reasons that you want to work on this?
Right, because there are a few key films that Michaud made that he's sort of known for, Within Our Gates, Body and Soul with Paul Robeson. There's some films that exist only in fragments, which have never really been written about. Some of the later work is kind of casually dismissed sometime as, you know, the silent films are serious films, but the later ones are, you know, and they've not gotten sort of the correct critical reevaluation that they need. And then also some of these other filmmakers whom we know less about, that, you know, in the academic world, Oscar Michaud is a household word. In the common movie culture, not that many people are familiar with him. So we're hoping to also, you know, bring back to the sort of cinematic film history vocabulary someone like Richard Norman, who even among cineasts is almost unknown, who is the white filmmaker who would make black cast films like The Flying Ace. You know, just sort of so that we're taking the films that have been written about in the film history context and presenting them in a way that, you know, is as true as possible to how they should have looked, but then also resurrecting the films that have fallen through the cracks, the films that have sort of been ignored just because they don't. No one has really told the story of the people who made those films yet.
Or don't exist necessarily in a way that would be easily exhibited. You know, a fragment or a short made by Zora Neale Hurston is not something that right. really there's a necessarily a way to exhibit it outside of a sort of a more museum setting. But here's this amazing discovery that someone who is known for one thing was doing something else, you know? Yeah. So, and that's an incredible revelation.
And there's so many there are the films themselves, then there's the whole story of how these films were made and who made these films. There's like a dozen stories there. And then the big challenge is how to make it more than just an artifact. How do we, it'll satisfy our usual clientele of film collectors and academics. How do we take it to a different audience who is otherwise not gonna see these films? And Paul Miller, AKA DJ Spooky, who had to slip out. I'm not Paul, he had to go. I'm Brett Wood, I produce a lot of films for Kino Lorber. You know, had this great idea of let's bring in more contemporary artists. Let me try to hook you up with people who can talk about these films and what they mean to us, and you know, put them in a context that contemporary viewers can relate to. And I think most cineasts just like seeing a movie that has never been available to be seen before. I think that's something we're all kind of tapping into.
But also to show that American independent film production didn't begin necessarily in the mid-50s. And that the lineage of American independent film goes from Oscar Micheaux to Kelly Reichardt. Right?
Yeah.
Like that it encompasses all. Sure. And all these people need to exist side by side, right? As part of this amazing thing that's taken place in this country since the dawn of the technology.
Right.
And I think that's sort of what's exciting about how these five projects are being selected and put together is because as disparate as the styles, narrative, doc, video, film, more contemporary, or the dawn of cinema, that they actually have more in common than they don't, which is like iconoclastic directors in cases of some, or other people who just are part of this ongoing heritage of people with limited resources, but ideas and something that they wanted to do, picking up a camera and telling it however they could.
And not always having a caretaker for the films that they've made. I mean, I think everyone here is, all their films were not made within the studio system, so there's no vault that's gonna preserve the negative.
Right. And the reason we're not talking about studio films here is because the people, those films that are in the vault aren't necessarily even ones that are accessible. Right. So it is sort of in our hands, you know, because when left in the hands of conglomerates, they're making the decisions and they're dictating what gets to be seen, what gets to be preserved, and that is normally dictated by market conditions. So that's why you'll have a filmmaker who's made 40 films, Oscar-winning films, but only half of them will be available because those are the ones that history dictated that audiences were interested in at that time. So that's why there's one Wilder film that is, or one Minnelli film that's shown all the time, and another one that you can't find a copy of, because so it doesn't even allow for the canon to reform, but we're sort of allowing for it and trying to engage other people who are also going to be interested. To Kelly's film, which I think people would be shocked to know that a film that was in the Sundance Film Festival in the early 90s, which is now only 20 years old, would be in need of help.
Right, yeah. As I said before, people don't know about this film. They're shocked to know that Kelly made a film nearly 10 years before Old Joy. And when the rights did come up, I'm sure she was feeling like, where is this gonna have a home? And wouldn't it be great if Oscilloscope would come on board, because she already has a home there. And you know, we really support her work. She's one of the most exciting independent American filmmakers working today and continually working. To see where she started out is really exciting. And to sort of have this preservation of her legacy, as you had mentioned, you know, we have women filmmakers that are working and directing things, but they don't always have a body of work when it comes to later in their careers. So the fact that Kelly is still making independent films is really awesome. And to go back to the first film is to revisit her history into our shared history and to see the American independence starting out at that time. She was in really interesting company at Sundance. Spanking the Monkey came out then, Go Fish, Reality Bites, Four Weddings and a Funeral. So a lot of those filmmakers did go on to have careers either in film or in television. So we're excited. And I totally forgot to mention that we have an amazing Kickstarter campaign going on with this, because Kickstarter invited us to be involved in this restoration initiative, obviously. So the campaign is live, so please visit it and pledge anything that you can.
One thing that's pretty exciting about looking at all these projects, and to go back to work specifically that is from the very beginning of cinema, is that, and just to sort of repeat what I said before, the state that the work is in sometimes negatively affects the way it can't even be accepted or viewed. There's too much of a distance created between a contemporary audience and what they're used to seeing versus a deteriorated product. And I know this is the case sometimes where films are viewed through the lens of like how they look, that it's difficult to take certain exploitation films seriously because so much of it is wrapped up in the way that we've only ever seen them, right? And allowing to restore and preserve and work with filmmakers to recolor time films or remix films really allows them to be seen in a different way. The content is always there, you know, whatever it may be. But it also just gives a different chance. So there's now going to be a document of, you know, the South Side of Williamsburg that's going to have a, going to look closer to the way that that area looked because the color is now finally going to reflect what it looked like versus something that's being seen through a red filter.
Yeah, we had been looking at that film on VHS for 4 years, and when we finally saw the scanned versions of it, not only was the detail completely remarkable, but suddenly it turned into cinema again. I mean, it was really, before that, we were looking at something that had been broadcast on TV, and it was a completely different experience. And kind of we're hoping to repeat that experience as well. We're hoping to do a small theatrical run in the city, and we'll be. There's been a nice sort of pairing with the interactive side of this project. It's brought new interest to it and allowed for festival runs to be possible. We sort of launched the project at the New York Film Festival in September, and have a number of other different possibilities coming up for places that it can go internationally. But also plan to do not only grassroots kind of events, and there will be Kickstarter levels where people can get the screening rights and for public screenings to Los Urres, and also educational and presentational rights. But we're also working with some experts to create an educational package around the film to talk about some of the main issues that are there. So it's kind of a really remarkable document, both with this sort of source piece from 84 and all the work that's been done to date to kind of unpack that and work with high school students and also universities. So that's part of our campaign too, is to get it into those spaces.
Great. Some questions from the audience?
It's really obscure. It's for Brett. I noticed in your little video, I didn't know if it was just stock footage. I noticed that the covers were just DVD covers, was just, you know, placeholder stuff you use for like a campaign. Was that footage of the film actually being scanned, or that's just stock footage you have from old scans?
It was footage of us scanning film from a previous project.
Okay, I was just curious.
I understand how you restore celluloid film. What can you do, if anything, to restore videotape?
Oh, is that for me, I guess? he shot the film on a video rig, but it was 1-inch tape, which fares a little bit better than actual standard VHS. So he placed it properly in, you know, a container to keep it from molding and aging and losing, you know, its magnetic identity. And so it's actually not going to be just like transferred from another tape, but something shot on a camcorder, there's really no reason to ever hope for a 4K scan DCP of something that was shot on a, you know, Radio Shack video camera. But we do have the master tapes. We're going to be operating from them. And because this project isn't an existing film, like really all of our focus from what we're going to raise on Kickstarter goes to completing it. And the real challenge there besides editing and doing the sound is that there's no musical score at all. And so Annie and Joe, the other Bleeding Skull staff, they have a band that is coincidentally called Taken by Savages, which is the name of which is the plot of the movie. And they're going to actually purchase period accurate synthesizer equipment and drum machines and do the soundtrack to, along with the notes from the filmmaker, what he wants, you know, to his approval. And so everything is going to be done accurate, but to the adorable limitations of the format, which you addressed. So.
Other questions? Follow up.
Sort of. I have a sort of restoration project I'm considering. Can you, I guess, give like a ballpark estimate of like how much does it cost to restore a scan a celluloid film, restore it? Like, what's the sort of general cost differential per, I don't know what you would measure it by, a minute or something?
I can share a little information. Just today I had a meeting with an archivist and we were talking about not one of these films, but another restoration project where we want to release on Blu-ray. But the film, 35 millimeter film, has not undergone photochemical restoration where you make a preservation negative. So there's preservation, restoration. So preservation means you save it and you put it in a stable film format that will hopefully live for generations. And so we were talking about this project and that doing a preservation of this particular film was not in our budget and was not something we were going to raise in Kickstarter, because he said it's like, we're talking $200,000 to do a proper 35 millimeter preservation negative of this film. You know, we don't work on that scale. We do more restoration, where archives like the Library of Congress, UCLA, Museum of Modern Art have done the preservation, and now how do you share it with the world? Because you've got 35 millimeter print, and then a lot can happen between that and what you see on the screen. In the way the film's scanned, in the way the film's color corrected, in the way you try to do digital restoration and clean up without changing the texture and content of the film. We're working on another film right now called The Sadistic Baron von Klaus. And we got a beautiful scan of a Jess Franco film, but baked into the negative are these printer flashes where the printer is not in sync with the cuts of the film, so at every splice, whoosh, you get this little blink. And so if we were being true to the 35 millimeter negative, that would all be on video, but no one wants to see this little flash of light every time there's a cut. So we will do little things to enhance the film and make it a more seamless viewing experience, but hopefully without DVNRing it and erasing the grain and the texture, because it, you know, what makes a shot on VHS film, half the charm is that you sort of see the texture of direct-to-video photography.
I'm just curious to get your guys' take on sort of the digital takeover of the film world, and the work that you guys are doing, a lot of it is going to end up in the digital sphere with like DCP projection versus 35, and basically only one film lab still in operation in the US. Is there something being lost in that? I mean, just in terms of the projection experience from your, you know, expert opinion?
Experts.
Yes.
I mean, I continue whenever possible to make 35 millimeter prints of films. But at the same time, those are not necessarily restorations. You know, it can happen on some cases, but it's a trade-off. For me, making a new 35 millimeter print, and I find for the films that I work on, which are usually repertory films, that the audience is more interested in seeing a new 35 millimeter print of something that might still have some flaws in the negative, more than you know, a pristine digital copy.
If I can speak to that for a moment, I mean, I think it's just a matter for a lot of people, and maybe those that you're talking about, of having an experience that you can't have at home. Like, the reason to go out and share, you know, the experience of watching a movie with somebody makes it all the more unique when it's in 35 millimeter. And I think that still has power for people who are aware of that type of thing. But that number of people who are aware of the difference, I think, is also diminishing because of the attention span.
It depends on the film. It depends on what its accessibility has been previously, the condition of the materials. There's what's even possible, you know? But I think maybe all of us sort of philosophically have ideas about this and then maybe direct our efforts towards the projects that we think match up closest to sort of what we want to undertake. And there are enough people all over the world who have different levels of interest in different things that make an incredible variety of projects that are being worked on.
If you ask any sort of directors, I think, talk to a lot of directors, they would rather see a beautiful DCP of something rather than a crummy, beat-up 35-millimeter print of something missing splices and faded.
But if they have some involvement in it, because there are a lot of filmmakers who see DCPs that have been restored by the studio who say, I don't know whose movie that is. You know, everything is just turned up bright, yes. And they just, you know, that wasn't the way it was looked at. So I think they're not exactly like hard and fast.
It's very subjective too. I mean, I have a very it's cliche to say it, but I do love film grain. You know, when I see that, and for real, it's like I almost have an emotional connection to when I'm watching a film rather than like a DCP, because I feel like I can tell that there's like a coldness to a digital print. But am I happy to be seeing that film? If there's no other format to see it in, sure, absolutely. You know, I love the storytelling. But yeah, I think it's, you know, film is a different medium than digital pixels. And it comes down to some subjective kind of feelings about it, too.
I agree with
anyone
the
else
format.
On that?
I know I already talked. I'm sorry.
I
mean, it's if the best song that was ever written in the world was only available on a single, and that was the only way you could hear it, that's how you'd listen to it, you know? And so I just want to say, like, that's how I always look at it. I don't love VHS. I love movies, and a lot of them are only available on VHS because that was the last stop for them. So
I guess what's might when this initiative starts and then goes on and on and on is that it's allowing people who are very serious about it to sort of debate and consider this, that it's not just being done in a factory manner. So if there, it is subjective, but then there are different people who have different opinions who have dedicated some thought to it, and there's an audience that has a sensibility that might match to the decisions that are being made, both the types of films that are being chosen and then the way they're being preserved. But I think this is giving people a little bit more of an opportunity to have a hand in what they want to support versus what they're given.
I think it's the opportunity is there, but it is also based on the material conditions, like you said before. There's so many other factors that go into it. For us, we're really dedicated to trying to have a 16 millimeter preservation, and that the New York Public Library actually paid for that to happen. And Diego was quite involved in trying to make that as good as it could be. Unfortunately, the results of that actually were less than satisfactory for exhibition. Mm-hmm. And the scan that we were able to make was much more rewarding. And Diego, there was no question in his mind what he wanted to go out with. Our whole perspective was the other way around. You know, we had much preferred to, you know, we still show 16 very regularly at Union Docks and would much rather have done that, but for the material conditions we were dealing with, that was the only way we could go.
Right, and no one's looking for expediency. there's something that's been given some thought to. Here, please.
Have you had a problem with lost footage and lost films and gatekeepers?
Just before we send that, gatekeepers meaning like estates?
Yeah, gatekeepers or people who have it or don't release it. Like you have this great gem and you can't get to it because of the gatekeeper, something unseen, B-roll footage, things like that of iconic movies. And it's just you can't.
Every week. You know, in addition to doing archival stuff, we also release a lot of films to the studios, and it is a scavenger hunt almost of tracking down the rights and determining which studio has it. And there's films we know they have, and some studios will say, "I don't think that's ours," and we're like, "It's yours. We know you have the film. Can we release it?" "Eh, we're not sure that's really ours." And so, you know, it happens on that level, and then. There's archive politics of some archive wants to, we want to release this ourselves one day, but fortunately, most film archives want the film circulated, so if there's a particular gem that they want to hold for themselves, they will typically offer us another film instead. But it's half detective work, and that's, I think, one reason I enjoy it, and I think a lot of my coworkers as well.
Anyone else on the topic?
There's a person in this room who has a really great story of trying to get the rights from the immediate rights holder who was the filmmaker. Evan Husney here, who works for Vice and used to work for Drafthouse Films, is trying to release a movie called Miami Connection, which is another lowbrow film that was made by somebody who didn't have experience. And the person's life was so destroyed by investing everything into this movie that then never had any life in 1987, that when Evan called him in 2011. He's just like, "Hi, is this Master YK Kim?" "Yes, it is. I want to talk to you about Miami Connection." And he hung up on Evan twice a week for, yeah.
He thought we were playing a practical joke on him.
Yeah. He thought it was like 12-year-olds.
The film is like now out and playing and
yeah, and then the film persevered. It was a midnight movie success, you know, to use that silly term, but like. It was a huge hit, and that guy ended up embracing it and doing like a news or a Entertainment Weekly piece about it and stuff like this. But at first, he thought like Evan was a 12-year-old that was playing a prank.
Yeah, and then it was the first time we ever met face to face after we had signed the deal with him, and he looked me in the eyes and he said, "Why did you buy this garbage?" And I had to explain to him, "No, this is an amazing movie." And then that night was the premiere, and it went over, and it was a huge success. And then ever since then, he was super enthusiastic about doing what he could to get it out there and help us, which was really cool.
So it's like, so the reason I wanted to tell that story is like sometimes it's the studios holding up the print, sometimes there's just some legal mess, and sometimes it's even you're fighting the people who made the movie so you can release the movie, which is an insane mess.
Bad experience.
Yeah, but it war at all sides all the time.
I think we have time for one more.
Yeah, I'm actually just interested. Where do these films end up in a digital platform in terms of digital archiving? Or is it, are you guys relying on the 35 or 16 or whatever film prints to, you know, archive this?
You're talking about,
I mean,
archiving?
For, you know, future generations.
Right. Yeah, just because it's on DVD doesn't mean it's preserved and safe for the, you know, the next generation. Yeah, well, there's lots of different ways to preserve stuff. Mm-hmm. I think, Brett, you may have a little more better insight than I do. A couple of anecdotes. One, which just sort of shows that, you know, there's every few years there's a new way to preserve a film, and you just have to sort of bear in mind that it's never done. No film has been preserved and is going to last forever. You have to constantly, and digital preservation has not been around long enough for us to even know how long it's going to last. But one of my favorite heartbreaking stories, I made a documentary about driver's education films made in Ohio back in the 60s, the Death on the Highway type things. And I, through the person who owned the company who made the films, found out he had donated the original 16 millimeter AB negatives to the Ohio State Highway Patrol. And like after much haranguing, he put me in touch with them. I finally got to the person who knew about the films, and they said, oh, no, we got rid of all that stuff. And I was like, but we converted it all to VHS. And that was it. They made a VHS and then junked the 16 millimeter negatives. So we have to always be careful that, you know, HD is not forever. 4K is probably not forever. So don't throw anything away. Right. I guess that's the
Horde. Did you direct Hell's Highway?
I did.
I like that
you
movie.
You know, thank you. Yeah.
Can I follow up real quick about that?
So do you guys store these films on servers or like, yeah, it's true, like DVD, Blu-ray, there's always going to be that new format, but when you guys are doing these 2K scans, where do those files store and how long can they be stored? I mean, I guess we don't exactly know that, but what are your plans for storing that digitally? So if you need to make another 35 print, say, down the line, you can do that.
For us, you know, we'll back stuff up onto hard drives as well as digi-beta sometimes. Various physical things you can put in a player and recapture if you need to. That's what we've done. We have never done any kind of photochemical restorations. It's too expensive. We were involved with one project, which would have been fantastic, but the director wanted photochemical preservation, going from 16 to 35. We just couldn't afford it. So that's my sad story.
Magnetic tape, I think. We have a... the preservation copy is in the library. The best copy won't be circulated ever. So there is a film version of that will be there for generations. You know, in addition to hard drive, the plan is to have it on magnetic tape that has like a 15 to 30 year window, and you know, continue to back that up.
I have a happy story. I was talking to Todd Weiner at UCLA Film Archive, and there's a film we want from them, and he got back to me and said, yes, you can use the film, but it has not been preserved yet. And we think that as a result of our inquiry and this project, they're going to first do a 35 millimeter preservation of the film, then do the scan for our version. So hopefully this will result in the preservation of God's Stepchildren, an Oscar Michaud film. And one little thing I'll add, and maybe I'm preaching to the converted here, is that make a $1, make a $5 donation just so you can sort of follow the narrative of what we're all doing, because if you're like me, I find this almost as fascinating as the finished films themselves, the struggle that we all go through to sort of keep, you know, this sort of, I don't want to say the underside of film history, but I would say like the not always publicized side of film history alive.
It's neglected, and this is an opportunity to get it out there in a much wider audience, because I think all of these movies do deserve a wider audience. And, you know, whether it's Ethnographic or just some sort of a German crime film or a made on VHS action extravaganza, people will watch anything. I'm convinced of it. People will watch anything as long as they have, it can be a cachet, but as long as there's a form for them to do it in. And I think this will also raise awareness for public exhibitions. I think we all would love to see these projects publicly exhibited outside of, you know, cities like New York or Los Angeles.
And it's also an art form with just such a small life thus far that will hopefully continue as long as there's civilization, I suppose. and it will then morph into ways that we can't even perceive right now, just how inconceivable digital might have seemed, you know, when people were looking at zoetropes, you know? So it is a chance to sort of like have a hand in a sort of reshaping and realignment and reassessment of what's important. and not leaving it up to, you know, a small group of people.
Yeah. Following your anecdote about the highway safety films being destroyed, I was going to ask if anyone of you or you know if it's true. I heard a rumor that at one point, Wizard of Oz and its original materials were almost destroyed by the studio while they were culling a bunch of stuff for space. And I just wanted to like tell that story because that movie is so crucial to our
culture.
Yeah, they
saved it from actually being, put at the bottom of the ocean. It's actually the negative for Wizard of Oz is at the George Eastman House, I think in Rochester, New York.
Because they were going to dump it?
They were going to dump it in the
a
water.
A funny apocryphal story about that is when...
Yeah, that and Gone with the Wind.
When a certain studio was cleaning out their vaults and they wanted to get rid of all the outs, they figured, of Days of Thunder, they accidentally got rid of a lot of outs for Days of Heaven. Now, but the point of that is that 50 years from now, Days of Thunder might be... like, you know what I mean? So, like, in some ways, it might be like a relief, but we don't know, you know.
Well, it's the same too with *Night of the Hunter*. All those deleted scenes were given from the widow of the filmmaker to UCLA, and they were using it in film class to teach students how to edit. So they were editing all these outtakes from *Night of the Hunter*, and they were saved.
The flip side of that is the lost Todd Browning film, *The Unknown*. Believe lost forever, discovered in a can in the basement of the Cinémathèque Française, labeled unknown. So, stranger things have happened. You know.
Yes.
So I think that's a wrap. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, guys.